Well, good morning and welcome as we gather for our online worship here on Sunday, September the 11th, 2022. It's been a very eventful week, hasn't it, with the passing of Queen Elizabeth II and all the acknowledgments, all the memories that many of us have of the powerful monarchy she has been and the many times she has visited Canada, 22 times. And as many have shared, that Canada was one of her favorite places to always visit. So we will take time to remember and to pray for the royal family. But also with today being September the 11th, it's also the anniversary of one of the events that shook our world. And that is the events on 9/11, 2001. I don't know where you were at that time. I know where I was. I was sitting in my office probably just about 9 days into being the minister at Petrolia. And, you know, I was unprepared, really caught off guard. You know, I was still new to ministry. I'd just been ordained, just started my first ministry. And to have that event take place, it was just so shocking. And I just remember the first Sunday afterwards, the number of people that came to church looking for hope, looking for healing, and how our world changed after that. Hard to believe, isn't it? It was 21 years ago today. But today, one of the things that we get to experience is holy worship. So I thank you for joining us. I just ask that, pray that you will take time to be incensed with God today, to be able to explore time with God today, that you will draw close to Him in the most amazing ways. So let us start off, shall we, with an opening prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give our thanks and our praise because you are our God. And we know, God, that you are with us. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for the many things you have done for us through the course of this week. As we gather for this worship, God, we just ask that you speak to us very clear words today that gives us hope, that gives us the uplifting we need, and that allows us to realize how blessed we are to have you in our lives. We offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Well, let us continue our worship now by singing our Welcome to This House, followed by Holy, 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 and our opening hymn for you.
Thank you. goodness.
To desire the relationship that you do. We know, God, that you have so many people to have a relationship with. But when it comes to us, you make us feel so special, like we're so important, like we're so blessed. And we should treat you the very same way, to make you our priority, to make you number one in our lives. And sometimes we do. Some days you are our most important person. But other days, we put you to the side. Other days, we may neglect you or forget about you or just get on our busy ways that we haven't spent quality time with you. And you're saying, my child, I was waiting. I was hoping, I was expecting that you would be with me today and spend time with me. So God, if there's been any of those times through this week, we say how sorry we are. And if there's been any times through the past week that we have sinned and erred, once again, we say how sorry we are. Because we know, God, that one of the things that happens when we spend more time with you, we're conscious of your holy ways. We're conscious of your right living. And we're more adamant. We are more able to say yes to your holy ways. So if we have said no to any of your ways through this week, this is the time we confess. Say that we're sorry and ask for your forgiveness. Thank you for being the God that you are, forgiving us, restoring us, and uplifting us, and giving us the peace that we need. So God, help us never to take you for granted. Help us to always put you number one in our lives, and help us to stay committed to holy and righteous living. We offer this prayer in Christ's name, who taught each and every one of us when to pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, we continue on with our memory verses now. And we're moving in to Psalm 139. And it's so interesting as we move into the psalm, the one passage that really jumped out to me that I think can be a very powerful memory verse. It's verse 5, found in Psalm 139. And this is what it says. You go before me and follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. There's so much to unpack in this, isn't there? The fact that the psalmist is saying how you, God, go before me and you follow me. Isn't that so reassuring to know that as we walk into the unknown, as we walk into a new day, God is walking before us. And then to know that whatever choice that we make, that God is following us, trying to steer our path, maybe from a wrong path to a right path, from maybe a confused path to a path of more clarity. As we see, the psalmist is saying that you go before me and you follow me, God. What a reassurance that is to know that we're not alone. But here's the other thing the psalmist says in this verse. You place your hand of blessing on my head. And how reassuring, how comforting that is, that each day God is placing his powerful hand, his hand that is all controlling, his hand that is all loving, and he places it on our head to place his blessings upon us. Isn't that a wonderful way to take into each day, knowing that no matter where we go, God is going before us, that God is along the way, and to know that God's hand is placing a blessing upon us. With that as a memory verse, we should have so much to look forward to, so much confidence each and every day. May this be a memory verse that blesses you. Well, for our story time and pondering time today, I went back into my past and went back into my hockey past to get one of my hockey helmets when I played goal, because today's focus in our message is looking at how a man named Naaman had to go through a very uncomfortable walk and journey in his life because his world turned upside down. So I began pondering that and thinking, well, what would happen if we had to do certain things upside down? And I'm not going to do a handstand for you. I'm sorry, but I'm not that limber. I'm not that mobile. And I don't think the camera would go down, and you don't want to see my feet up, and you don't want to hear me maybe make a loud noise at the end. But here's what I did. I got out my hockey helmet and I began playing around with it. And I had the mask taken off recently because my daughter Coral could fit my hockey helmet. I thought, well, that's pretty cool. But here's my mask that, you know, in my days, I had the wire mask. And if you look really closely, there's a huge dent right there where a slap shot hit me right there. I couldn't get my blocker, couldn't get my glove hand up quick enough. And it made a good little dent there, but it didn't touch my nose. Imagine how much bigger my nose would be if it got hit with that slap shot. But imagine for a moment, if I took the mask and had to wear it upside down in a hockey game, well, this is what would happen. My eyes now would be where my chin strap used to be, and I wouldn't have a very clear vision at all. You know, I would just be standing there and couldn't probably react and respond to any of the shots. And also, here is my chin guard. And again, what was it meant to do? To go right here. To make sure that no stick and no puck hit my neck, because, you know, as we know, it's a very sensitive area. But imagine if we had it upside down. I couldn't see, and my neck would no longer be protected. It'd be a very different experience, wouldn't it, if I had to wear this mask upside down. Now, the same is true with my helmet. Again, I didn't have one of those plastic masks like you see the goalies wear today and, you know, have so many different paintings and different pictures on it. No, this was me back in my days wearing a helmet just like this. Now, imagine if I had to wear this helmet upside down. Here's where it would be. Now, can you imagine how helpful that would be if I had to wear my helmet upside down? Wear the mask upside down. Again, I wouldn't have the protection for my head. My sides would be very exposed. The back of my head would be very exposed. And it'd be pretty uncomfortable trying to balance this on my head and maybe having a strap under my chin. And this is the way I would look in a hockey game. It wouldn't be very safe, would it? It wouldn't be very comfortable. And it would look pretty silly as well. Well, sometimes our life is turned upside down. And for many of us, it's a very unpleasant, it's a very uncomfortable walk. But what I want to ask you today is this. When you have that uncomfortable walk in life, Where is your focus? Are you focusing solely on how uncomfortable it is, how silly I must look, how unpleasant all this is? Or instead, is your focus on God? That even though this is unpleasant, even though this is uncomfortable, God is still guiding me. God is still following me. God is still placing his hand of blessing upon me. So, what is it when your world is turned upside down, say by an illness, say by a job loss, say by the death of a loved one, or so on? Are you focused on being uncomfortable because your world is tied upside down? Are you finding yourself not able to see God properly because your world is upside down? Or are you seeing, no matter what I'm going through, God is guiding me, God is following me, God is placing his hand of blessing upon me? That is what I want you to ponder, because let's be honest, at some point in our lives, we all go through uncomfortable changes. That's our story time. That's our pondering time for today. Well, let us continue now by singing. So God, we once again ask that you open our eyes and ears and minds so that we can truly take in everything you want us to learn. Because here's our goal, God, to get stronger in our faith so that we get closer to you. We offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Well, today we're going to be looking at when God says no and have we heard God right? And one of the best examples we have of this is a story we find in 2 Kings chapter 5, and I'm going to read it for you now. It's verses 1 to 16. It's of a man named Naaman, a commander in this army of Aram. And one day, he came down with leprosy. And as we know, it was a situation that was often hopeless at that time. But he was told that there was a prophet in Israel who could help him. And we discover that when he got there, when things weren't going according to expected, when he had to walk a very uncomfortable walk, he thought God was saying no. But his fellow officers told him, That's not what God was saying. He was saying yes to just a different way. Let us learn in lesson from 2 Kings 5, verses 1 to 16. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means go," the king of Aram replied. "I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I am sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? So see how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me." When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message, "Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him to say to him, "Go, wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." But Naaman went away angry and said, "I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed?" So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he tells you, wash and be cleansed?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel. So please accept a gift from your servant." The prophet answered, "As surely as the Lord lives, whom I serve, I will not accept a thing." And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, here we are on the third week in our series of When God Says No. And remember in week one, when we looked at when God says no, what most people focus on? The word no. But what did Moses focus on? Not the word no, but on God and God's character. And because God had said no to him to entering the promised land, because he focused on God's character, he accepted it. He didn't get angry. He didn't get upset. He didn't walk away from God. He accepted it and stayed loyal and faithful. And what did God do in the end? He blessed him with some very special thing, didn't he? Taking him high up to Mount Nebo and showing him all the promised land. He was able to see it with his own eyes and even seeing the walls of Jericho. And then last week, we looked at when God says no and the importance in those moments not to doubt God's love. Because remember, when God said no to Adam and Eve, when it came to eating the fruit of the tree of knowledge of what is good and what is bad, what did Eve do? She began to doubt God's love. And Satan was able to twist it, wasn't he? And it resulted in that poor decision. It resulted in the consequences we have of this fallen world. And we learned something, didn't we? We learned these three things. All because God says no. It doesn't mean his love for us has changed. Just because God says no. God's love is our one true consistent. It's our one true constant through whatever challenge we're going. And because God says no, it doesn't mean that when we are hurting, that God isn't hurting too. Because that's what love is. When love sees one of their loved ones hurting, love reacts the same way. So, we've learned so much, haven't we, already in our series, When God Says No. Well, today, we're going to look at another aspect, When God Says No. Did we hear him right? And one of the best examples we have of that is in our story today about Naaman. Now, I want to start off with two things that Naaman was not used to. Here's the first thing, needing the help of others. Because Naaman was used to being the one called upon when someone needed help. For instance, when the king of Aram needed help in fighting a battle, who did he call on? Who did he rely on? Naaman. Or if his fellow soldiers needed help coming up with a strategy, maybe readjusting a battle plan, who did they turn to for help? They turned to Naaman. And if there was anything in his household that someone needed help with, who would they go to? Of course, Naaman, being the head of the household. So one thing Naaman was not used to was needing help from others. But here's something else that Naaman was not used to. And that is hearing the word no from others. Because think about it. He was so respected by the king of Aram. If Naaman ever had a request, as long as it was reasonable, don't you think the king would always say yes to any of Naaman's requests because he wanted to keep him happy? He knew he was so loyal and he was a very vital asset to him. Or if he gave an order to any of his fellow soldiers, would they say no to Naaman? Of course not. They knew the line of authority, the chain of command, so he would never hear the word no from any of his commanding officers or soldiers beneath him. And he most likely never heard the word no from any of his servants around his household. So, two things that Naaman was not used to was needing the help of others and hearing the word no. But something was about to change that would require him to walk on uncomfortable ground, and that is leprosy. It changed his world. It changed his life. Because from what we know of the times of those days, when somebody had leprosy, it basically was incurable. And because it was very contagious, most people who came down with leprosy had to live outside of a town or a village. Well, it would appear that because Naaman was still living at his house, because Naaman was still active, it probably was in its early stages. It maybe was a form that was not contagious, but regardless, it turned his world upside down. One day, one of his servant girls, a girl from Israel who had been taken in one of the raids and brought back to serve as Naaman's wife's servant, said to her master, "It would be so nice if my master could go and see the prophet in Israel. He could cure him of his leprosy." Don't you see the faith? And don't you see the courage and loyalty of this young Israelite lady? Even though she was taken from her home in Israel and brought to serve in this household in Aram, she still showed love for her master, saying, "I know that this prophet in Israel, this man of the Lord, could help and heal him." Well, this is what Naaman needed to hear, because now he had hope, but he realized that if he was going to go through with this, he would have to seek the help of others. And if he was going to go through this, he might have to hear the word no from time to time. Was he willing to do it? Would he go on the path of hope? Or would he stay what he knew, not needing and seeking the help of others and not hearing the word no? Well, what won out? Hope. So this began a very uncomfortable journey for Naaman. It began with him going to the king of Aram and having a request. Could he go to the king of Israel and make this request? Well, of course. The king of Aram said yes and helped him by sending a letter of introduction. And basically, that letter was basically a guarantee. I want you to give your best to this man. I want you to help him in this journey. So, at least he heard the word yes. Now, he went to the king of Israel. And what did he hear for the first time? The word no. Because the king of Israel thought, there's no way that I can cure him of this leprosy. And that probably the king of Aram is wanting to pick a quarrel or a fight with us. For one of the first times, he heard the word no. But thankfully, Elisha, the servant of God, heard about it. And he said to the king, why don't you send him my way? Well, that began another journey for Naaman. And I'm sure along the way he was thinking to himself, why do I need to go to the prophet? Why didn't he come to me? Aren't I a man of respect? Didn't I receive this letter of introduction from the king of Aram? Shouldn't they be showing me respect in this situation? So as you can see, probably this thought process, a bit of uncomfortableness was going through Naaman's mind at this time. Well, when he got to the house of Elisha, instead of Elisha coming out, he sent one of his servants out and told them to go and wash 7 times in the Jordan. Well, remember what Naaman's response was. He was angry. He was upset. And because of it, he was going to refuse and walk away. Why? Why? I think for 2 reasons. One is, he was on an uncomfortable walk, wasn't he? Needing the help of others. It was something he had to do for the very first time. And again, because this was uncomfortable for him, what was he doing? He was focusing on his thoughts. He was focusing on how pleasant this was instead of really listening to what the prophet had to say. But here's the second reason why I think he mistook what God said through the prophet. He had expectations. His expectations were this, that the prophet would come out to him and maybe wave his arms over him or maybe place his hand upon him. And all of a sudden, call out in the name of the Lord of Israel, and all of a sudden, he would be healed. He had an expectation of how this healing should be. Well, when it didn't go according to his expectation, what did he think he was hearing? No. But is that what God was saying? Not according to Naaman's servants. Remember what the servant said to him. Sir, if the prophet has told you to do something very difficult, wouldn't you have done it? So you should certainly obey him when he simply says, go and wash and be cured. Isn't it interesting? At least they realize God wasn't saying no here. He was saying yes. But Naaman was taking it as a no simply because, one, he was focusing on how comfortable all this was, focusing on his own thoughts and on what God was saying. And 2, thinking, this should be done according to my expectations, my desires, not to how God wants to go about it. That is the reason. And if he hadn't listened to his servants, if the servants hadn't been wise enough to speak up, Naaman would have missed out on the healing. It was an uncomfortable walk, an uncomfortable journey that he had to do simply because he had expectations that he had of God in there too. And he almost missed out on an amazing healing and miracle. Now, should we blame him? Should we criticize him? Maybe not. Because maybe that's how we feel when we have our world turned upside down upon us. Because it happens, doesn't it? The death of a loved one. An illness like maybe name an experience. Maybe a job loss. Maybe it's a relationship breakdown, a separation, a divorce. Maybe it's a healthcare situation. Whatever it is, our world can be turned upside down. And don't you think Naaman was probably raised in a similar way we were? You know, taught. You need to learn to be strong and independent. Self-reliant. Don't ask other people for help. You know, it's okay if they ask you for help, but if you begin to ask other people for help, you're going to be perceived as needy. No, be strong. Put on that mask. Try to persevere, even if your world is turned upside down. Don't you think that is what Naaman always learned? And unfortunately, that is something that we have been raised and grown up to. Don't ask others for help. That's showing you're needy. Instead, be strong and self-reliant. Again, we have learned that along the way, maybe been raised on that. That's why we find it so hard to ask other people for help. But the other thing that maybe we have done too is learned along the way that it's okay to ask God for things. It's okay to come with expectations. But maybe we forget, or maybe we overlook, what did Jesus do in the Garden of Gethsemane? Yes, he had an expectation. Yes, he had an ask. And that was for the cup of suffering to be taken away. But what did he do? Not my will, but your will be done. And if God doesn't do things according to our expectations, are we taking it as a no? And when really, God is saying, my child, I hear your expectations, but I've got a better way to answer this prayer. And that is, I think, something we have to understand, because maybe God is not saying no to us, but it's just saying, I've got a better way, far better than what your expectations are. So as we see, something Naaman had to do is relearn, readjust in this situation. And I think sometimes maybe we do too. When the world turns upside down for us and we are forced to walk in a very uncomfortable way. So, what is the first thing that we must relearn? I think it's this. Asking others for help does not mean we are a needy person. Yes, we may have been taught that, but that doesn't mean that is true. Asking other people for help is a position of strength, because why? We realize we can't do it on our own. We realize that we need the help of others. And by so doing, we're going to go on a journey where we begin to discover more about ourselves, discover more about God's grace, how sometimes he uses others to help us in those situations, so that when we go through the healing process and get to the better end of it, we'll be able to do the same for others. Because why? We can be empathetic. We've experienced it, and we will be able to help them. So no, asking other people for help does not mean we are needy. We need to see it for what it is, that it is a position of strength. We realize we need help at this moment, and it's with the journey of getting better, getting stronger, experiencing God's grace along the way. So that's the first thing we need to reteach ourselves. Ask others for help. Ask God to lead you to those other people who can help you in those situations. The second thing we need to relearn is this. That God may have a better way to say yes to our requests than what our expectations were. Because remember, what was Naaman's expectations? Well, for basically the prophet to come out, wave his hands, call out in the name of the Lord and heal him. But by doing it in the way God did, by having his servants impress him, and ask him to go and wash in the Jordan, as the prophet was saying. Let's look at the better way that God answered this prayer. Naaman afterwards realized that there is no other God like the God of Israel. He became a believer in God. Secondly, don't you think his commanding officers would have also been beginning to believe in God as a result? Third, Think of the servant girl in Israel in Naaman's household, because it was her advice that led him to go to Israel. Don't you think when he came back, she would have been lifted into a far higher position in the household, much like Joseph was in Potiphar's household? Or maybe she was given her freedom as a result. As you see, a far better way. And the other thing that God did in this situation is taught Naaman about grace. That this healing was not because he wanted to give this money, whether it was the clothing or the shekels of gold or so on, that this was God's free gift to him. He taught him about grace. And as we need to see, God knows best. He may have a far better way to say yes to our prayer request than we could ever come up with. So, if we have our requests, and we're putting our back up, we're becoming hesitant because God is not doing what we are doing, make sure we're still listening. Make sure we're hearing God properly, because he might be saying, yes, my child, I just want to do it in a far better way. As we see, this story would have played out so differently if Naaman had not listened to his servant's advice. Thankfully, he did. And let's make sure that we never make the same mistake, because we could see it could lead to us suffering that much longer. Yes, there'll be times in our lives where our world is turned upside down, where we're going to have to walk in uncomfortable ways. And if that should ever happen, may we take the lessons forward. Asking the help of others does not mean we are needy. That God will lead us to some people to experience healing and grace, and that we should always listen, because God may say no to our expectations, but must be saying yes to a better way. Powerful lessons to take away from this message. God bless and amen. Thank you. prayers of the people today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give our thanks and our praise because here we are just 3 weeks into our message, and you've shared so many wonderful, powerful messages to us. And yes, you've reminded us that at times our world can turn upside down. A pandemic certainly did that for us. A health crisis can do that. We know that things just change so suddenly, and all of a sudden we're forced to walk in maybe an uncomfortable way. But you've shown us today, God, that when that happens, that we know that you're with us, that we know that you are guiding us, but we also know, God, that we just can't be focusing just on how uncomfortable it is, but listening closely. And even though we may be broad expectations to realize, maybe you have a better plan in mind to heal us or help us. So God, if that happens, may we not just take it as a no, but say, God, are you saying yes to a better way? And like Naaman, experience that better way. We know, God, our world has been turned upside down this week with the passing of Queen Elizabeth II. She has been a consistent in all of our lives, the many years that she has served in the monarchy. She has been so visible, so prominent, and we know, God, that this came so unexpected. There she was on Tuesday, welcoming the new Prime Minister of England, and 2 days later, passing away. A nation is mourning, a Commonwealth is mourning, and we just pray over Her Majesty. We know that she is reunited with King Prince Philip, and we know that she is with her true King, you, God. We thank you for her monarchy. We thank you for all she's done. We pray over her family right now. We pray for King Charles, for his succession. Thank you, God, for everything that we've experienced through Queen Elizabeth II. We continue our prayers for Don Pritchard. We know that Don is battling a health issue right now, and we continue to lift him up to you. We miss his special music very much right now. So we continue our prayers for Don and Jane and Amy and the family, just to pray for your strength and your comfort and your well-being to be with them. It's hard to imagine that 21 years ago today was 9/11, God. We just pray for the families who are still grieving and mourning that tragic day. Be with them, God. Give them peace, give them strength, give them comfort on this day of remembering. We pray for our children. We know that they're back for the first week of school. We pray that it's been a good week for both teachers and students. And we just continue to pray over them, God, for your blessing in hand. We don't forget our prayers for the people of Ukraine. Our prayers are for that nation to experience peace and stability once again. We keep them in our prayers. We uplift them through their suffering. God, we pray for the grieving. Help them to be comforted at this time. We pray for those going through emotional turmoil. Help them to know your hope will sustain them. And we pray for the many who are struggling to make ends meet. May they lean on you and know you'll provide. We give our thanks and praise for this time of worship. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for being our God. And we offer this prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Well, let us join now in singing our closing hymn.
Thank you.
2022. I hope that you have been touched and inspired by it, and that you have been blessed in some powerful way. And again, it's still going to be a very powerful and emotional week over this, seeing the celebrations of Queen Elizabeth's life and preparing for her funeral service that'll take place at a later date. I pray for God's blessing upon you in this coming week. And again, if there's some point you would like to join us, I look forward to seeing you for our in-house worship. After the benediction, we'll sing Let There Be Peace on Earth, followed by O Canada, our ongoing tribute to our frontline workers. And now, the benediction. Unless our eye catches fire, Christ will not be seen. Unless our ears catch fire, Christ's words will not be heard. Unless our tongue catches fire, Christ's name will not be proclaimed. And unless our hearts catch fire, Christ's spirit will not dwell within. So may our hearts, minds, and spirits burn with a love for God, with a love for one another, and with a love for God's world too. God bless and amen, and we will see you next time.